Proximity sensors come in four flavors: inductive, capacitive, magnetic, and ultrasonic. Inductive sensors detect metallic objects, capacitive sense non-metallic objects, and magnetic proximity sensors detect magnets. This video will focus primarily on inductive and capacitive proximity sensors. Magnetic sensors are covered in a separate video. Ultrasonic sensors are used for object detection, but they're also used for distance sensing, so we'll look at those in more detail in the distance measuring video. Detection ranges for these sensors max out around these numbers. Some proximity sensors do have analog outputs, so they can do some distance sensing, which is really helpful when setting up the system to make sure the sensor is in a good range to detect the object. Note that the ones that operate over larger distances are going to be the larger units. There are two different mounting options for these barrel-style sensors. One is optimized for flush-mounted applications. It's threaded all the way up to the face. It's called a shielded sensor. And one sticks up like this. It's called an unshielded sensor. The shielded flush mount sensors typically have a shorter sensing distance. The reason for this is the sensing region actually starts below the face of the sensor, kind of like this. So when you flush mount one of these in a metal bracket, you're actually choking out a portion of the sensing region and reducing the range. That's usually not a big deal, of course, because if you're flush mounting a sensor, it's probably because the object is sliding right over the sensor, so distance isn't a big issue. Can you connect proximity sensors in series? Sure. Why would you want to do that? Well, suppose you have three sensors, and you only want to know when all three sensors are active at the same time. Well, normally you would run all three into a PLC and make that decision in software. But what if the sensors are a long distance from the PLC and you don't want to spend the money running three sets of cables? Or maybe you're running low on PLC inputs. Well, then this is a neat trick to have in your toolbox. If you have a three-wire NPN sensor, then wire it like this. Connect the sensors and the PLC to 24 volts. Connect the first signal wire to the PLC and the negative terminal of that sensor to the signal wire of the next sensor. Do that again with a third sensor. Finally, connect the third sensor's negative terminal to the negative supply. Now the PLC won't get an active input signal until all three sensors are active and provide a path to the negative supply. How many sensors can you put in series? Well, that depends on the sensors. If you look at the spec sheet, you can see a parameter called voltage drop. That's the voltage drop across the sensor. Looks like this one is 2.5 volts. So if I have 10 sensors in series, they would need 25 volts. But I only have a 24 volt supply, so that isn't going to work, is it? So the maximum number of sensors in series depends on how much voltage you have available to drop across all of the sensors. When placing sensors side by side, a good rule of thumb is to leave at least one sensor diameter of space between them so they don't interfere with each other. Keep an eye on the switching frequency of the sensor. Looks like this one is 5,000 Hz, but you might see some that are 100 Hz. So if you're trying to detect objects moving by faster than 100 Hz, like gear teeth for example, and you're using a 100 Hz sensor, then you're going to miss some of the objects. So be sure that the switching frequency of the sensor is high enough to capture the objects you want to measure. I like for my switching frequency to be at least twice the rate of the objects I'm trying to detect. How do you know which type to use, NPN or PMP? Well, that depends on what you're connecting the sensor to. The main thing to know is sinking and sourcing are always paired up. If the PLC is sourcing current from the positive supply, then the sensor must be sinking current to the negative supply. If the PLC is sinking current to the negative supply, then the sensor has to provide the source of the current from the positive supply. How do you remember which is which? Well, if the sensor is sinking current to the negative supply, then it's NPN. Think of N for negative. If the sensor is sourcing current from the positive supply, then it's PMP. Think of P for positive. Sensors that come with wires already connected are handy and tend to cost less, but the sensors with quick disconnect cables allow for quick replacement of sensors. So if you have an application where short downtime is critical, then consider using the quick disconnect cables. It'll save you money in the long run. Proximity sensors typically have indicators to tell you when the sensor is active. I love that, but it's not always easy to see once a sensor is mounted, and sometimes I really wish I could tell if the power was connected correctly too. Well, look at this. You can get cables with indicators built in that show you the supply status and the status of both outputs. They're much easier to see than the indicator on the neck of the sensor, and now you can tell if the system is wired correctly at a glance. There's also various length patch cables with the LED indicators that you can just insert temporarily to do tests and diagnostics. Can you use a proximity sensor in a vibrating environment? You can, but keep the vibrations below 55 Hz and a max amplitude of 1 mm for no longer than 30 minutes on any axis. Will a magnet trip a proximity sensor? Well, it can. If you have a capacitive sensor, the answer is yes, since they detect non-metal objects. If you have an inductive sensor, the answer is it depends on how much metal is in the magnet. The TV spec tells you how long it takes the sensor to become stable. It looks like this one is 30 milliseconds, so don't expect stable results until 30 milliseconds after you apply power to the sensor. You can typically expect proximity sensors to repeatedly detect objects within plus or minus 5%. The smaller, short-range sensors will be more accurate. The best way to tell what kind of connector a sensor uses is to look at the last character of the part number. An H is a 12mm 4-pin connector that all of the Automation Direct M12 cables are compatible with. This is the same connector as Allen Bradley's Micro QD and Turek's Eurofast. An F suffix is the 8mm connector, which may be 3 or 4 pins. Make sure you select the correct one. These 3-pin connectors are what Turek calls PicoFast. Speaking of connectors, these multi-port junction boxes are really handy for combining groups of 4, 6, or 8 sensors into a single cable. That makes cable management for a bunch of sensors so much easier. Also, don't forget to order mounting brackets with the sensors. They're inexpensive and they save you the trouble of finding and making your own. With all the different form factors, output types, cabling options, etc., choosing a proximity sensor can be a little overwhelming. The good news is the Automation Direct website has a fantastic parametric search that will help you find a sensor you need quickly. For example, if I click on inductive proximity sensors because I want to detect something metal, I see there are 266 different kinds today. But if I narrow that by selecting a size and a sensing distance, I can quickly get that down to just 6 options. That parametric search is a huge time saver. Well, that ought to be enough to get you started with proximity sensors. Check out the how-to videos that show you how to connect these to a PLC and then program the PLC to use them. If you have any questions, please contact Automation Direct's free, award-winning tech support during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help you. And don't forget the forums. There are lots of folks there that love to share their years of experience. Just don't post any support questions there. Automation Direct support staff doesn't monitor the forums on a regular basis.